Good morning, everybody, and welcome to worship live on Facebook and YouTube this morning. We welcome you, whatever platform you're joining us on. We welcome you as we gather together in this way to worship our Lord and Saviour, to praise His name, to lift Him high this morning. As we gather together, let's pray, and then I'll hand over to Noel as he leads us in our opening thought before we sing our first song this morning, Refiner's Fire. So let's pray. Lord God, we come to you, Lord, this morning, and we just thank you and praise you, Lord, that we have been given the gift of another new day. Lord, I pray, Lord, that as we gather together, spread out this day over the internet, Lord, that we will focus solely on you, Lord, that we will lift our eyes to you, our hearts to you, Lord, this morning in worship, in praise, in adoration. Lord, that you will teach us what it means to be your people for this day, Lord. Lord, I pray, Lord, that as we listen to your word, Lord, that you will just be working in our hearts and minds with your Holy Spirit this day, transforming us more and more into your likeness. Lord, I ask this in and through your name. Amen. I'm going to hand over to Noel as he opens with a verse of scripture.
Good morning, and welcome to Brigham Baptist Service. We're here to worship God. We're here to pray in the glory of God's name. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, as we gather to meet with you, and each other. As your church around the world gathers together, Lord, we ask you to bless. We ask you to open our hearts to hear the word of God, to hear the voice of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And to many people, Lord, might know about you, might be just for the first time heard of you, don't understand. Help us, give us the wisdom, Lord, to speak clearly. Give us the wisdom to explain the gospel of God as best we can, but depending on the Holy Spirit, teacher. And as we read the word of God, Jesus, we speak it clearly. And it touches the hearts of your people. We ask you to bless this church, bring along and on, and whoever else rests in. But in general, we pray for the whole church of God on earth. That whoever speaks and whoever is willing to word, that the people that hear, listening, hear you, your voice. Thank you in Jesus' name. Again, as we do gather, it's quite strange for me. I find it very strange to not have you talking to a crowd of people that I can see. But God knows, and God knows the heart of each and every one. As you come before Him this morning, come open the heart. Come openly to know that Jesus loves you. Jesus is on your side. And He wants you to hear your message here this morning. And the first reading we have today is Psalm 1. And the psalm reads, Blessed is the man who does not walk counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sits in the seat of mockers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields fruit in season. And whose leaf does not wither, whenever he does prosper. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the sinner will perish. And again, that little sound. Contrast clear. Contrast between the righteous and the wicked. The contrast between the sinner sitting and walking with the wicked people. And interesting that it talks about walking, standing and sitting. And that's what we do every day. Every day. Walking or standing. But the warning is, God's word is still sound. Be careful
who you want.
Be careful who you shipper. Be careful
who you
stand. His word says, what is the light in the law of the Lord. And on his law meditates day and night. That word meditate, think about it. Not at all. Read the day that whatever I read, we read later on, you meditate, think about it. Take time out, sit down with God. And let him, the Holy Spirit, speak into your heart again. And then he shows the example of Jesus. In the parables, always talks about what's going on around Burn. The psalmist here is talking about things around Burn. Some of the things are very familiar. To me, especially as a gardener, talks about he's like a tree planted with streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaves does not wither. Wherever he does, prospers. And that's fairly obvious. We all know if you plant a tree, and I plant you today. If you plant a tree beside the water, it will flourish, grow. And you plant it in a desert place, drought, dies. And there he compares the person who walks close to the law, walks close to the Savior, sitting or standing or walking, you're with your Savior, in the shadow of the Almighty. And the contrast. The wicked. They're like chaff. The wind blows away. And again, if you're out in the country in the last 2 months, you've been a combine all over a place. And as they drove down the field, the wheat was collected. And the great thing about it, and our dog comes up and up, and the children love it. And the chaff is blown back. It's like dust, blown away. But the seed is collected. And in their act, David writing, he hadn't got combine, but he was well aware of the corn collected and the beaten drum up in the air. The seeds fall to the ground, the wind goes to chaff away. And the contrast here is the righteous man delighting in the Lord, growing beside the river, not in the desert days. The righteous man being seed collected by God. And the wicked have been blown away. And he says, not so the wicked, they are like chaff. The wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the wicked will perish. And again, it's so straightforward. Again, we often hear people say it's not black and white. It is actually black and white. It's clear as crystal. And with the word of God, there's areas that we don't know about, but the clarity of the difference between a saved person walking with Jesus and the unsaved is clear. One perish, and the other is brought home to glory. And as we think on those things, go back and read a little psalm. Ask God to bless your heart. Ask Jesus to open your understanding. Ask God to encourage you to understand the word of God and listen to him. In a world today that is in a bit of turmoil, as especially in the last 6-8 months with the pandemic around about, so many people have spoken in my own life and everybody else, I'm sure, where is God now? God is where he always was. Reaching out to his people, reaching out to Annie and everyone that will listen. But a lot of times we don't listen. We ask God to bless again. We ask Jesus, this word of God. We ask you to bless the singing that will come later. We ask you, God, to bless the preaching of the word. We ask you, even though we can't have fellowship together, that through Zoom and through different ways, that we connect with each other. But in the most obvious way, let us connect to you, Jesus. And your word often says, go into your quiet spot and talk to our Savior. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Noel, for that. And sorry about the echo there. I've managed to figure out what was going on, so hopefully we won't get that back today. Going to continue in worship as we gather together just now, as we sing a lovely song, Refiner's Fire. Thank you very much for joining with us as we sang. Set apart for you, Lord, ready to do your will. What great words we were singing. I pray, Lord, that that is each one of our prayers this morning. We're going to turn to Malachi again as we continue in our series on Malachi after taking a break last week as Noel brought us his message. We're going to return to Malachi chapter 2 and verse 17, which is the last verse of chapter 2, and we're going to read up to verse 5 of chapter 3. So Malachi chapter 2 verse 17 to chapter 3 verse 5. You have wearied the Lord with your words. But you say, how have we wearied him? By saying, everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delights in them. Or by asking, where is the God of justice? Behold, I am sending my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, and the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire, and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the sons of Levi and refine them like gold and silver, and they will bring offerings in righteousness to the Lord. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord, as in the days of old and as in former years. Then I will draw near to you for judgment. I will be a swift witness against the sorcerers, against the adulterers, against those who swear falsely, against those who oppress the hired worker in his wages, the widow and the fatherless, against those who thrust aside the sojourner, and do not fear me, says the Lord of hosts. Shall we pray? Lord God, as we look at this word this morning, Lord, we thank you. Lord, that we are able to read it in our own language. Lord, that we're able to understand the words written. Lord, I pray, Lord, that it won't just be words on a page. It won't just be something that was written a long time ago. But Lord, as you are alive, Lord, that you will bring these words alive into our hearts and minds just now. And Lord, so that we hear your voice today. Lord, I ask this in your name. Amen. So, as we continue in this series, you'll remember the first week we looked at the fact that Malachi was written around the same time as Ezra and Nehemiah. It's after the people had returned from Babylon back to Judah, the southern kingdom, and into Jerusalem. They'd rebuilt the walls and the temple, and the people are expecting God's presence with them, and they're not recognizing God's presence among themselves, and so Malachi writes and speaks into this situation, and he does it with a series of questions, a series of statements by God, followed by questions by the people, saying, well, how is this? What's this all about? And God then answers their questions. And it starts off with God saying, I love you. And the people ask in chapter 1, how have you loved us? We don't see any evidence of this right now. So how do you love us? And it goes on, and then it comes to where we pick up today in chapter 3. That the charge is that they've wearied God, that God is weary of them rather than them of God. And so the people's complaint today is, how have we wearied you? What is it that we've done that you find so tiresome, God? And so that's That's a context of what we're reading today. And the main thrust of these verses, only six verses in total, is that we need to take justice seriously. Remember in week one, it was we needed to take God seriously, we needed to take worship seriously, he picked up on that in week two, in the majority of chapter two there, where he focused on the priests and how they worshipped, and we looked at relationships and all of that in week two. And so we come today where we take justice seriously. How we treat people shows where we stand with God. In other words, so we're going to try and unpack that a little bit this morning. But let's turn to chapter 2, verse 17 first. And this accusation that the people in Malachi's day have wearied God. God is worn out by them. Again, as I say, it's set as a series of questions and answers. And God says the way in which they have wearied him is that everyone does evil. So everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord. This is the general attitude of the people at the time. Everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delights in them. In other words, they're saying, what good is it for us to live righteously? What good is it for us to do the things that the law requires of us when all this calamity, all this pain, all these difficulties, all these things are happening to us? Our lives are miserable. And yet the people in neighbouring countries who do not know God, they're prospering. They're living life abundantly. So what good is it to please God? So we're not going to even bother. And that's basically what's been going on in Malachi's day. They've come back to Jerusalem, they've come back to Judah, and they've come back enthusiastic, they've thrown out their idols, they've worked really hard at obeying the law. And yet, there's still problems. There's still difficulties. The nations are still oppressing them. They're not an independent nation. They're still living under the governor of the Assyrians the Persians, and they're still feeling oppressed. They're still feeling as though God has abandoned them, and so they're saying, "Well, when we look at the neighboring nations, they've got it okay. We don't. What is the point?" Do we ever feel like that? When we look at those who don't know God, those who openly reject God, and we look at all that they have, when we look at their lives and the abundance that they seem to have, and we can say, what is the point of honouring God when our lives are a struggle? Our lives are a struggle. What is the point of obeying God when he doesn't give us the blessings that we think we should get anyway? It's so easy to fall into that trap, and the Israelites at the time of Malachi have fallen into that trap. And when we look at our world today, it's so easy for us to fall into that exact same trap. In other words, it's turning a lie into a truth, and a truth into a lie. See, God has promised to be their God. God has promised that if they obey him, he will shower blessings on them. But if they disobey him, he will bring curses. And he did that by sending them into exile into the northern kingdom, into Assyria. And the northern kingdom never comes fully back. Never comes back. The southern kingdom goes into exile into Babylon. And when the Persians take over the Babylonians and the Assyrians, they start sending the Jews back to Jerusalem and to Judea. And yet, there's a sense in which the curse is still being lived out, because they're still not independent. They're still not just God's people. They are subject to a foreign power. And so they're turning the truth of God's promises in the law, the first five books of the Old Testament, the Torah, or the Pentateuch in the Greek form of the word. And so they're turning what God has said on its head. And we see this throughout the Old Testament. We see it in the Garden of Eden, where the serpent says, "Well, did God really say? And then, you won't surely die. It's good for you." And we hear this all the time, don't we? We hear this not only in Scripture, but we hear this in our own lives. Can we really trust God? I was listening to a message the other day on Right Now Media, on their conference actually for 2020, and it was online, as everything is these days, so I was able to listen to it, I was really challenged by this idea of believing in God, or believing God. In other words, do I just believe he exists, or do I actually believe what he says? Do I actually trust him in everything? In other words, is he just somebody who's out there? Or is he somebody I have a relationship with? When God says something, do I take him at his word? When God promises something, do I take him at his word? When God warns me about something, do I take him at his word? It's an important distinction. Can we trust God? And in our day, the lies that have been turned into truth, and the truths that have been turned into lies. So some of them will be quite personal for you, but some of them are also wide, society-wide. The society-wide ones, for our day, is based on creation. Did God create? Yes or no? The Bible tells us he did. Do we take him at his word? Do we believe what Scripture says about creation? Or do we believe the world? Do we believe the lie? Do we believe God's ordering of creation? In other words, gender. Do we believe gender is as it is in Scripture, or do we believe that there are multiple genders, that we can be anything we want? Do we take God at his word, or do we believe the lie? You have your truth, I have mine. There's no ultimate truth. God says he's the only source of truth. Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Do we believe what God says, or do we believe the lie? The world tells us that everyone deserves to go to heaven, even though they don't believe in God. that no one deserves to go to hell, even though they don't believe in it. Scripture says no one deserves. It's only through the grace of and the blood of Jesus, the grace of God and the blood of Jesus, that we even get to go and be with God in eternity when that time comes. Do we believe the lie, or do we take God at his word? This is really important stuff. And that's what Malachi is dealing with in his day. He is dealing with, do they people trust God or do they not? Everyone does what is right in their own eyes. And we see that in our day, and we see it in Malachi's day. Tony Evans in his commentary says, in their eyes, God was blessing the sinners and afflicting the saints. And so they turn God's answer back onto him by asking another question. He said, where is the God of justice? If God is a God of justice, if God is looking out for his people, where is the justice? Where's the justice in sinners being blessed and the saints being afflicted? Where is the justice in this? Can we trust God? This is really a question that reveals where our heart is. Can we trust God? Can we trust his ways? Can we take him at his word? It reveals whether we have faith or whether we have a lack of faith. Whether we have what we would term today belief. But it's more than just believing, it's about taking God at his word. This verse is reminding them, according to the expositor's commentary, this verse is reminding them, and I would add, and us, that God is tired of hypocrisy. God is tired of inverted morals. God is tired of spiritual blindness. And God, as he deals with the people, that's what he's dealing with. He's dealing with apathy within worship. He's dealing with saying it doesn't matter how we live our lives because it doesn't work anyway. He's tired of this. He's tired of people using God's name but not living his way. So this morning, is God telling us he's weary with us because we use his name? We sing songs about him. We read books about him, as well as scripture. And yet our lives are saying, what's the point? Paul dealt with it in Romans. He says, you know, some people are saying that because we're saved by grace, that because we can't work our way to heaven, well, it doesn't matter the way we live our lives. Paul says that is rubbish. My paraphrase. That is absolute rubbish. Of course it matters how we live our lives. It doesn't save us. But because we are saved, because we are in Christ Jesus, because we belong to God, because we are in the family of God, it matters how we live. And when we don't live God's way, we weary him. And he's tired of it. And so God says he's going to do something about it. He's going to take matters into his own hands. So let's look at God's answer at the beginning of chapter 3. God's answer to the people's complaint is, behold, in chapter 3 verse 1, behold, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me. Behold, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me. The custom of the day, in Malachi's day, was for the king to send a messenger ahead to prepare for his coming visit. That was a custom in which the people lived. So if the king of Persia wanted to come and visit his subjects in Judah, he would send a messenger ahead to prepare the way so that when the king arrived, they were ready to receive him and to honor him. And God is using this language within the prophecy that Malachi is giving us to show us what he is going to do. He's going to send a messenger ahead of himself to prepare a way for his coming. So the point of the messenger is not the messenger. The point of the messenger is to prepare the way for the coming king. So the question is, who is your king? God is declaring his kingship over his people. They might have an earthly king in Persia somewhere, and in years gone by they asked for an earthly king within their own nation, which God in his grace and his mercy allowed, but was never his plan. But he allowed it. And out of that allowing, he brings what he had promised in Genesis chapter 3. That he was going to do something about. He was going to send someone to deal with the problem of sin. He was going to come himself and deal with the problem of sin. So God is reminding them that he is their true king. By using this phraseology, by saying this is the order in which he's going to do things, he's telling them he is the true king. You have no other king but me. In other words, worship me. And I'm going to prepare the way so that when I come, when I arrive in your midst, you will be not only aware of me, you will be ready for me, and you will be ready to worship me and to honor me. Which is my due as God and King. That's what God is saying to the people, and that's what God is saying to us today. Of course, we know because we don't live in Malachi's day, we live post this, we live post New Testament. We know who the messenger was. The messenger that Malachi is talking about, and God is talking about through Malachi, in chapter 3, verse 1, is John the Baptist, who comes to prepare a way for the coming king. And all the Gospels, Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 to 3, talks about that. And he actually uses this text in Malachi to show that John the Baptist is the preparer of the way. John's Gospel is great for looking at who John is and the way in which he prepares a way for Jesus, the King. We'll come on to that in a minute. Again, Tony Evans in his commentary says, a clear path must be made by cutting down the mountains of human pride to make a humble plain for God's glory to land on. Sounds a bit of a mouthful in some ways. And yet, what Tony is saying is that if God had just turned up, people would not have been ready. He needed to prepare the way. And what he needed to do, he needed to cut down, to beat a straight path to himself. And the things that were getting in the way, all the woodland that was getting in the way of a clear path, is our pride. I deserve God's blessing. I deserve to have an abundance in life. I deserve my own way. All of that is the root of pride. When we go back to get the Garden of Eden, the root of it is pride again. I want to be equal with God. It's my own pride. The Tower of Babel, it's our pride that leads us to want to reach the heavens in our own strength and our own might. And so God needed to cut down the mountains, the woodland that is blocking the path to him, our pride. And so he sent his messenger, John the Baptist, ahead of himself to prepare a way. Today, this is a work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. The work of the messenger is to show us our sin and our need for repentance, so we are ready to receive the Lord. The work of the messenger is to show us our sin and our need for repentance, so we are ready to receive the Lord. Ahead of Jesus' coming, that the work was John the Baptist. Since Jesus' ascension and Pentecost, that work has been the work of the Holy Spirit. Although I would say it's always been the work of the Holy Spirit throughout the whole of the Old Testament. It's just embodied in a human being, a prophet, John the Baptist, who humanly did that work as the messenger who prepares the way. And as I say, today that is the work of the Holy Spirit. The Lord is coming. He is preparing the way. He's preparing the way in our hearts and in our minds as we allow him to minister to us, as we allow him to reveal sin in our lives, to bring us to our knees in repentance, so that we are ready to receive the Lord Jesus. That is the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives today. Malachi was prophesying about John the Baptist and ultimately about the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So the Lord is coming. We go back to Malachi's day. As I say, they had rebuilt Jerusalem, they had rebuilt the temple, but God was still absent. God's glory hadn't filled the temple like he'd promised. So the question is, why? God had promised to return to Jerusalem and to the temple. And when we look back before exile, when we look back to Moses, when we look back to Solomon, so Moses with the tabernacle, the tent of meeting, as it moved from place to place with the Ark of the Covenant, wherever the tabernacle was, God's presence filled it. And it was visible. It looked like a smoke and cloud and all of that. You can look in the book of Exodus for that. And then we move forward into Solomon. When Solomon built the temple, God had told David that his son would, when the temple is open, God comes and physically, with a physical demonstration of his presence, fills the temple. Isaiah sees it in his vision, when he is taken up and he's at the throne room. He says that the temple was filled with the glory of God. And so we see that wherever God is in the Old Testament, in his house, whether it was a tent or whether it was a physical building, he always manifested his glory in a physical way for the people to see and for the people to know that this is the house of God. And so the people saying, why isn't this the case? We built this new temple for him. We're trying to obey the law, and yet God is not present amongst us. Why is that? God had promised. God's promise was for an even greater show of his glory than with Solomon's temple. When he would bring them back and make them his people again, he would give them an even greater display of his presence and his glory. So what's going on for the people? They're saying this isn't happening. Why is that? We don't understand God. We've given up. And as we move on into the New Testament, when we move on for our day, and we look at it and how it applies for our lives. The New Bible Commentary says this: only the glory of God in the person of Jesus Christ is greater than the display of God's glory that God gave Solomon and Moses and Isaiah. They were all pretty much the same. The only way that that can be greater is the display of God's glory in the person of Jesus Christ. God, in his answer to the people, acknowledges that even in their sin, the people long for deliverance through the Messiah. He says, I'm going to send my messenger ahead of myself, and then my messenger will come. In other words, then I will come, then the Lord will come in your presence, who you have longed for, who you have longed, whom you delight. In verse 1 again, he says, I read verse 1 of chapter 3 for you again. Behold, I am sending my messenger, this is John the Baptist, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. And the messenger, this is still talking about the Lord who you seek, and the messenger of the covenant, Jesus himself, in whom you delight, behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. So God is acknowledging the fact that they're actually desiring it. They actually do want the Messiah to come. They just don't know what he's going to be like and what it's going to mean. God is revealing how he is going to fulfill his promises. But he warns them in verse 3 that they're not going to like it. He said, because when he comes, he's going to refine you. You're going to be like silver and gold in the refiner's fire. You're going to be brought to melting point, so that you can be the person I want you to be. When gold or silver or anything goes into the refining fire, it gets rid of the dross. In other words, all the impurities that is in it. And now, I'm not a goldsmith. I've never actually physically been a part of this process. I've seen videos of this type of thing happening. So I can visualize in some way what's going on. But I can't draw an experience because I've never been part of this process. But we're told, and we know, that when the gold or the silver goes into the fire, it burns away, it draws out all the impurities, the dross, so that the finished product is without blemish. And the more it goes through this process, the more impurities are pulled out. And God is saying through Malachi, that when the Lord comes, when I come amongst you, when you see the glory of my presence, Jesus, he's going to refine you. He's going to draw out the impurities from you. He's not going to allow you to stay where you are. Yes, you can come as you are, but he's not going to leave you there. He cannot leave you there, because if you are left there, you are going to still weary me. You're still going to be hypocritical. You're still going to question me. You're still not going to take me at my word. You're still not going to trust me in every detail of life. So I have to take out the impurities. I have to take out the things that draw you away from me in order to mold you into my likeness, which is what I created you to be. We were created in the image of God. And although we still bear that image in a very broken way, as all humanity, But as God's people, God is restoring us, making us new, so that we are the image of God. He says, the day of the Lord is coming. It is a day of judgment. It's a day of judgment where I will judge those according to what they have done with my son, according to what they do with my presence amongst them. Do we accept him or do we reject him? Of course, Malachi had in mind, to some degree, the first coming of Christ. Post his first coming, post his death, his resurrection and ascension, we are looking forward to the day of his second coming. We just did a series on Revelation. We don't need to go over that ground again. To remind us that we will be called to account for what we have done with Jesus. The day of the Lord is coming, and those who are not in Christ Jesus will not be able to stand. Those of us who are in Christ Jesus, the only way we can stand is in Christ Jesus, because of his blood that has cleansed us, washed us clean, so that God can clothe us in his righteousness, not our own. And so I'm reminded that the day of the Lord is a future event, but it is also any day that God steps into history to do special work. Whether it is a work of judgment or whether it's a work of deliverance. And that special work takes place primarily in our hearts. The greatest miracle in the world today is changed lives. It's not the external stuff. As great as they can be, and God can and still does that. We're not saying that God doesn't. But the greatest miracle is a changed life. And any day where God comes in and changes a life, that is the day of the Lord. This passage speaks of purification and judgment. It reminds us that God disciplines his children. Remember, God is talking to his people here. He's not talking to the nations around them. There's other prophets do that. Jonah, one of them. Amos, Obadiah, they all talk about the nations around while turning it on to the people of Israel as well, apart from Jonah, who doesn't do that. But this passage speaks of purification and judgment. He reminds us that God disciplines his children for their own good. Hebrews chapter 12, we only need to look at passages like that to remind us that God disciplines his children for our own good. Because if he leaves us where we are, we're going to end up rejecting God. And he promises in verse 5 that I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you, yes, in judgment, but also in comfort. Because my presence will comfort you. Because my presence will deal with the things that draws you away from me. And once we've dealt with that, I'm here. I'm in your presence. I'm with you. You will be my people. I will be your God. And you will dwell with me and I will dwell with you. And that is basically the message of the Bible, isn't it? Though they thought God was being unfair, he reminded them of one of the greatest truths. The Lord has not changed. Therefore, they had not been destroyed. God could have destroyed them at any moment. He threatened to do so in the wilderness, and Moses interceded for the people. Remember, and God didn't do that. God could have done it at the moment of exile. He doesn't do that. He brings a remnant back. God has not changed, therefore they had not been destroyed. People change, but God is consistent and faithful. He is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in faithful love and truth. Exodus chapter 34, the passage I was just referring to with Moses. Therefore, his people receive grace rather than what they deserve. Tony Evans reminds us and tells us when commenting on this passage in Malachi. Therefore, his people receive grace rather than what they actually deserve. So we come on to our final point this morning. Take justice seriously. The mark of a good relationship is doing what you know will please the object of your love. The mark of a good relationship is doing what you know will please the object of your love. So in a marriage relationship, a husband should do what he knows pleases his wife. And vice versa, a wife does what she knows will please her husband. And they work together in that. And when they're both looking out for each other's betterment, when they're looking out for each other's needs rather than their own, the relationship grows and develops. Now, of course, we know we're human. We know we make mistakes, etc. And we don't always get that right. Not one of us gets it right every time. But that's what we're working towards in any good relationship. And it's the same with our love for God. And out of love, God's love, this is, out of love, God shows us grace and mercy because he knows that's what we need. He knows that's the only way we're going to, the gap between ourselves and him is going to be busy. See, and so he does that. He gives us a way to cross over the chasm. He creates a bridge for us through the cross of Jesus Christ. But he asks us to show that we love him by doing what pleases him. He asks us to show that we love him by doing what pleases him. Malachi lists a series of sins in verse 5. And I'll read them to you again. Just find it. Then I will draw near to you for judgment, he says. I will be a swift witness against the sorcerers, against the adulterers, against those who swear falsely, against those who oppress the hired worker in his wages, the widow and the fatherless, against those who thrust aside the sojourner and do not fear me, says the Lord of hosts. So Malachi lists a series of sins. Remember, sin is ultimately rejecting God. And therefore, our behavior is a symptom of that sin. Really. So the list that we have is as much about behavior, but it's the attitude behind the behavior that's actually God is trying to get at. Similarly, Paul lists a series of sins in Galatians, and he calls it the fruit of the flesh. In other words, the things we do when we reject God. And if our behaviour is constantly in these areas, we're actually telling God, I don't love you enough to actually please you. I don't love you enough to change my attitude. I don't love you enough to change my behaviour, to work on this with you. Paul counters this with a list of the fruit of the Spirit, which he says, if we're in Christ, if we have the Holy Spirit in us, then we will show kindness, then we will show love, then we will show self-control, etc. And you can turn to Galatians chapter 5 to have a look at that yourself. So Malachi does not divorce responsibility towards God from those towards other human beings. Neither does Jesus in the New Testament and the New Testament writers. The letters all remind us that our behavior, our actions towards other people show whether we love God or not. And Malachi is saying, this is how you've wearied me. The way you treat people, the fact that you're going off and you, instead of relying on me to meet your needs, you're going to the sorcerers, you're going to the witch doctors, you're going to those who practice false religion. You're going to those who don't know the truth, don't know the truth from a lie. You're oppressing those who have nothing. You're oppressing, you're not giving a fair wage for people's work. You're oppressing the widows, the fatherless, the orphans. You're oppressing the foreigners amongst you who I've told you not to do all of this. I've told you to bless them. I've told you to meet their needs. And you're not doing it. The way we treat people shows how much we love God. Now this is no legalism. It's not we have to get it right every single time. It's not that. It's more than the behavior. It's the attitude behind it. It's an attitude that says I don't need to do this. It's an attitude that says I'm better than these. I can trample on them rather than helping them. I can ignore them because I don't need them in my life. It's the attitude behind it that is the problem. Jesus deals with this in the Sermon on the Mount, doesn't he? How are we treating each other? Do we show that we love God in our attitude toward people, in our behavior towards people, with the way we treat people, the way we look after people, people who are different from us, people who have less than us? Micah picks up on this theme as well, and I just want to really leave this with you as we start to conclude this morning. Micah chapter 6 verse 8. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. So in conclusion this morning, God is preparing us. God is unchanging. God is faithful. He will refine those he loves. He disciplines us for our own good. And he calls us to show our love for him by doing what pleases him. To do justice. To love kindness. And to walk humbly with our God. Shall we pray? Lord God, this morning, just thank you, Lord, that you are unchanging. Lord, that you have sent your messenger before us. Lord, that you came and you dwelt amongst us on earth. Lord, that you died. You shed your blood to pay for our sins. Lord, that you rose again as vindication of your sacrifice. Lord, that you ascended and now, Lord, that you now sit at the right hand of the Father interceding for us. Lord, that you have sent your messenger, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, to us, to walk with us, to fill us, to work, to refine us. Lord, to teach us how to please you. And Lord, your Spirit goes out amongst the world. Calling people each and every day to you to change hearts so that they will fall at your feet in surrender to you, in humility, in repentance. And Lord, this morning I pray, Lord, for those who haven't done that yet, who are listening in, Lord, that they will humble themselves before you just now, and Lord, and will repent of all that lies behind their rebellion against you. And Lord, for those of us who are in you, Lord, if there's an attitude, a wrongdoing and hypocrisy, Lord, that we need to repent of, Lord, work on us. So, Lord, we're ready for you the day of your coming, Lord, the day you come to take us home to be with you. Lord, make us ready. In your name, Lord, I pray. Amen. We're going to sing again before we share the announcements and the benediction together this morning. And we're going to sing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure, safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. That day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts
above. Thank you for sharing with us as we sang together there. First of all, before we look at what's coming in the next week, the next days and week, Lord. I just want to remind you that you can give online as part of your worship. We have our PayPal account. You can also request a paying slip if doing stuff online isn't really possible for you. You can either request, send a text to myself or to Maggie, just requesting that, and we can post that out to you so that you can give by going into the post office or your bank and using the paying slip that way. Just to remind you that, and you can get hold of our PayPal account either on our website, our newsletter, or asking for the link if that's not working for you for some reason. The church, even though we're not physically meeting and therefore we're not in the building at the moment, we still have overheads to cover, and we do need to be able to cover those overheads. Those who are at the AGM will know that finances are a little tight at the moment, and so I just want you to really to consider between yourself and God how you give and how, you know, and the regularity and the finances involved in that. We don't only the treasurer would see anything coming in on the statement. That's all. I don't know who gives what and when, and I don't need to. It's between you and God, and obviously for accounting purposes the treasurer gets to see the accounts, but that's really it. So people won't know what you're giving. Again, I'm talking to our members, I'm talking to those who attend our church regularly here. Just to remind you that that is part of our giving, and to seriously consider before God what God is laying on your heart in these matters, please. So after our service this morning, we're going to meet together on Facebook Rooms for about 20-30 minutes for coffee and chat. The code is the same as it has been the last 2 weeks, so again we would encourage you to join with us on Facebook Rooms to share in coffee with us there. If you haven't received the code, again, just send me a text and I can pass that on to you. This evening we have our prayer meeting at 8 o'clock on Zoom. Again, the code is in our newsletter. If you haven't received that for whatever reason, again, just let me know and I can pass on the details. And we're also going to share communion together this evening as we after our prayer service. This coming Wednesday, we will have our Bible study. Note the change of date. It's a Wednesday this week at 8 o'clock on Zoom. We will be meeting for our Bible study. We're continuing in our study in John's Gospel, and we're in John chapter 2, verses 1 to 12 now. So if you want to join us for that, please do. Our Accelerate Youth is meeting on Friday at 8 o'clock on Zoom. The details for logging into that will be sent to the parents and to the youth themselves so that they know how to get on to that. And then next Sunday at 10:30 on Facebook and YouTube, we will be live for our worship. That's on Facebook and YouTube. So whichever platform is the easiest and the best for you, again, I'd encourage you to log on and to join us live next Sunday at 10:30. Just want to share some scripture with you in benediction this morning before we head over onto Facebook rooms. Again, just give me a minute with that just to get it set up and to get my own cup of tea together. Micah chapter 6 verse 8 again. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. Amen. And God bless you. See you all, hopefully, in a few minutes.